Good morning to all the dignitaries, teachers, and students present in this session. The series entitled Overcoming the Challenge of Antimicrobial Resistance, organized by the Department of Microbiology, Modern College of Arts, Science, and Commerce, Pune, Maharashtra. I would like to extend a warm welcome towards our guest speaker for today's first session, Dr. Ramesh Nachimuthu, sir. Welcome, sir. I'm glad to take this Nachimuthu, sir. Sir is currently exhibiting the position of Assistant Professor, Young Scientist, BSc, sir, National Joint Coordinator, IIMER, Antibiotic Resistance and Phage Therapy Lab, Bacteriophage and Therapy, sir, under the Department of Bioscience, School of Biosystems, Vellore Institute of Technology. Sir has completed his PhD in microbiology from Bharatidasan University, Tiruchirappalli, and is also a diploma holder in computer applications. Sir has worked as a principal investigator on many research projects funded by DSC, sir, Government of India, New Delhi, as well as Biosciences, New Delhi. He is also a host for research training fellow, developing country scientist. Sir has also received travel grants from various agencies such as DSC, CSIR, RMRE, IPMR. Dr. Ramesh sir has specialization in research areas of antimicrobial resistance, phage therapy, and infectious diseases. Sir has filed one patent and has 81 research publications as well as 3 book chapters in his credit. He has also presented papers at various conferences and seminars at both national as well as international levels. Sir is currently guiding 5 PhD students. One of his students has been awarded PhD degree. He has guided 1 PDS student and he has also guided many students for research projects from the various courses such as BTech, MTech research as well as MSc. Sir is a member of 16 various renowned societies and biology and a few American Society of Indian Initiative for Management of Antimicrobial Resistance, IIMER, International Committee for Taxonomy of Viruses, ICTV, European Society for Clinical Microbiology and Infectious Diseases, Switzerland. Sir has many international collaborations in different nations such as United States, United Kingdom, Australia, China, Saudi Arabia, and Canada. He is a reviewer for many international journals and is on editorial board of newsletter of Society for Bacteriophage Research and Therapy as well as International Journal for Bacteriophage Research and Therapy. Sir has exhibited many honorary positions at many national and international conferences and webinars. Sir has a teaching experience of 13 long years and is also on board of studies as a member in Department of Microbiology, Bharatidasan University, and is also on board of examiner in Bharatiya University, Coimbatore, Tamil Nadu. DSC served by Government of India on July 23rd. He has received Dr. Samthia Galingam International Junior Faculty Award for research, medical research and technology advances in science. University of Toronto, Canada on 7th November 2020. He has received Innovation Recognition Award from Technological Advances in Science, Medicine and Engineering Conferences, University of Toronto. Dr. Felix Herrelli Outstanding Scientist Award for his immense contribution in the field of bacteriophage research over a period of 15 years by Society for Bacteriophage Research and Therapy on July 2021. I would also like to make a note over here that sir has a biodata of 35 pages, and I have tried to just highlight some of the milestones from his biodata. So with this brief introduction, really a brief introduction, I once again welcome Dr. Ramesh Nachimuthu sir for this lecture series, and I invite him to deliver his talk. Dr. Ramesh sir, please start with your talk. Sir, you're not audible.
Very good morning to everyone. Yes, good morning. I hope my audio and slide is fine with you all. Thank you so much. Is it okay? Shall I continue?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, once again, and thank you all. Thanks to the management, and then the thanks for the Department of Microbiology, all the head, and then the principal, management, faculty members, students, friends. Thank you so much for this great opportunity. So as we introduced, thanks for the professor. So today I'm going to talk about the current trends in antibiotic resistance and bacteriophage therapy. Past 15 years, I'm working in the field of this AMR and then bacteriophages. Since you chosen the title of your conference, okay? So the problem with the AMR and then the alternate to the AMR, okay, that is the current scenario. That's what I just aligned with your conference title, and I'm going to talk this both the field. Usually, wherever I go, I used to talk with align the both AMR and bacteriophages. So, the current situation before the COVID and then after the COVID, now we are for the prophylactics alone, we are spending a lot of antibiotics. Initially, when I ask the question for anywhere, any students, any part of, so what they do, for example, what is the deadliest disease in the world? They used to mention it's HIV, and then TB, and then cancer like that. Now I can say that it's a superbug, okay? Superbug is the dangerous and the, even the cancer, AIDS, even the COVID, okay? I can say that. We'll see the AMR, and then we will talk about the bacteriophages. Sally, once again, confirm, is my audio fine?
Yes, sir.
Fine, thank you. Yeah. So, I'm Dr. Ramesh, I'm from VIT. We have 4 campuses in India, Vellore, Chennai, Bhopal, and Amaravati. We have more than 30 to 40,000 students around all the campuses. So you all welcome to our campuses, PBS to see our lab and all. The antibiotics. So antibiotics from, it may be from natural or synthetic or semi-synthetic nature. And natural in the sense, it may be from the microbes, especially from bacteria and fungus and actinomyces. And then this is a synthetic, so chemically synthesized, okay. So how it works? So the antibiotics is either way is a bacteriostatic or bacteriocidal. So bacteriostatics, in the sense, it won't, it just stop the multiplication, and then bacteriocidal is completely killed. Okay. So the classification. So it's based on the classification based on the structure, function, and the spectrum. The structure, we can say the molecular structure of the antibiotics. It's called this beta lactam ring. So I don't know how many have seen and heard this beta lactam ring. Mostly cephalosporin penicillin families containing this beta lactam ring, and also the carbapenem family. And aminoglycosides, the functions, always function is very important towards the antibiotics. So here the there are many ways of inhibition of the bacteria. So one type is not only one, there are many. So the inhibitor of cell wall synthesis, okay, when you consume antibiotics, it go on inhibit the cell wall synthesis, and another one is the protein synthesis, it inhibit the protein synthesis, and then the inhibitor of membrane function, and then the inhibitor of the nucleic acid. So and it antibody has a two broad spectrum of activities. One is the broad spectrum and narrow spectrum. The broad spectrum nothing but the bacterium once you prescribe, the patient may not infected with both the gram positive gram negative. Okay, for example, the patient may infected with gram negative. If you prescribe with broad spectrum antibiotic, it will also kill that gram positive and gram negative. So what happens? Since it's focused on the it kills both, but the patient infected with the gram negative, but it's not necessary to kill the gram positive because the gram positive is a normal flora. So when you weigh a human being, you just minus 2 kilograms per microorganism. Okay, so weight of the microorganism, we can say some bacteria, protozoan, fungi, it's all is normal flora. So you're also killing the normal flora. Okay, so not only you're targeting the particular bacteria, even if you are prescribing the narrow spectrum of antibiotic, like okay. For example, a patient got UTI infections, the causative agent may be the HS E. coli. So the E. coli is a gram negative. When you prescribe the narrow spectrum not only kills the HS E. coli, it also kills other gram negative bacteria present in the body. So what happens? Also the normal flora which is present in the body. So even if whether you are going with the narrow spectrum or the broad spectrum, we are losing our normal flora from our body. So the normal flora played a great role to protecting us, okay, from the pathogenic bacteria. Okay, also it does lot of good job within our gut. Okay, it produces a hormone, it maintains the pH. Okay, it does excellent job. And also there are many reports that we are saying that there is no nothing microbes present in the CSF, but there is a report from one of our collaborator, they are going to report it, our CSF containing the microbes. Okay, so the discovery timeline. So you all know that there are Alexander Fleming, he discovered the penicillin. So after the discovering of penicillin, okay, so what happens before this category, before 1930, 1920, we were using the bacteriophages. So as soon as we find out this penicillin, we start using this penicillin. And then also the scientists, taking the interest of finding out new antimicrobial agents. You can see here, starting with the 1930, and then 35, 40, 45, so many antimicrobials, antibiotics they discovered. Okay, so all the antibiotics. So the last novel agent to reach the clinic was discovered in 1987. Okay, so after that, nothing had happened. So you can see this. So all after that, what happens? We have changed the site chain of the antibiotic. Okay, we have changed the site chain of the antibiotics, and then we are used as a first line, second line, and primary, secondary, like that we are using. So even though we developed a lot, but there is a big discovery void. Okay, the past 30 years we didn't find out any new antibiotics for this the bacteria. Okay, it just started. So the resistant timeline. Okay, so as soon as we introduce the antibiotics, even the Alexander Fleming itself, he mentioned that as soon as you find out the antibiotics, okay, or antimicrobial agents, that will become a resistance. Okay, because when you keep on using the antimicrobial agent to the microbes, okay, It knows and it become mutate, and then it knows how to escape from the particular antibiotic. Here I can give the example that 1928, you can see here in the blue circle, the resistance of the penicillin, become 1940, it become resistant. The same 1953 for the tetracycline, and then 1948 and 1985, that's the carbapenems. Okay, they introduced 1985. Okay, in the 1993 it become resistant. So whichever the antimicrobial agents, even if you are finding out a new antimicrobial agents now, today, it will become resistant after 5 or 10 years. Okay? So there are so many issues happening. I'm just going to tell you. So in the Europe alone, there are 25,000 people die each year. Okay? There are 5 key resistant bacteria called HS E. coli, Clostridium pneumoniae, Enterococcus species, and then Pseudomonas aeruginosa, resistant Staphylococcus aureus. Okay? So just see, and England alone, okay, there are 2 bacteria called, the past 5 years, they noted that E. coli is the most common cause of bacterial infections, okay, in the blood, followed by the Clostridium pneumoniae. So whenever, wherever the clinical, we go to clinical microbial laboratory, we see the sample size, and then if you see the isolate, the top one is the Clostridium pneumoniae, E. coli, Pseudomonas, okay, this comes. So the over-the-counter drug food product manufacturers around the globe. You can see here there are 46 companies around in the US, and then there is a toll from India, and 10 from China, and 5 from Korea, and Singapore too, and each other countries as one, Costa Rica, France, Canada, Spain, Taiwan, Turkey. So this everyone asked the overcome the production of antibiotics and then the prescribing of our own drugs. This is a big problem. It's actually this data is given by the Dr. Kiran Mazumdar. He also he shared the data. Yeah. So the prescription, there are 74% of the antibiotics prescribed for the general practice. You can see here, just rest of the 26%, this after this 74%, we are prescribing for the resistant on our normal practice, but 74% is the total too much quantity of antibiotics we are using. And it says 11% is the hospital inpatients, maybe IC patients, and then 7% is the hospital outpatients, OP, and then dental practice 5%, and 3% for the other community settings. Okay, so this huge, we are using huge number of antibiotics, and then there's shortage alert on support box. Okay, so in India, for E. coli, E. coli resistant to third generation cephalosporins. So in 15, 80%, and then they are in 2030, it's also 80%, not that generation. The world, when you see, 1565, and the world 77%. And when you see the clethalin only resistant to carbapenemids, see the 100. This is the biggest issue for us. Okay, this is the biggest issue for us. And then India 100%, and in the world other 50% is increasing. So we need to it's a very 2018 data. Okay, and then the human healthcare antibody usage in India. You can see around the India. And the 2000 and 2015. And it is now it is expected more than 18 to 20%, and followed by the Chinese, Turkish, and Brazil, Vietnam, Pakistan, Egypt, Indonesia, Algeria, and Russia. So there are few countries also included in this list, especially the cephalosporins, third generation cephalosporins. Okay, third generation cephalosporins. So once the patient got infected with third generation cephalosporins, we used to go with the other category of the antimicrobial. Now we can see the global rise of superbugs. So this. The expectations, okay, expectation of this death in the year of 2050, okay. So, 2.25 million number of people sicken each and every year because of the misuse of antibiotics, okay. This is the numbers, and we will share, okay, here another, the African and Asian countries will share 90% of the death, okay. 10 million people will lose it because of this superbug, okay. So, the global trends in the life, especially livestock. Okay, see here, 2013 it was 131,000 tons. Just imagine, it's not even a kilogram, it's tons, 1,31,000 tons, and then 2 lakh tons in 2013. They expected the overall expectation of the globe. So, totally 67% increase and 100% increase in India. Okay, so this all we can say, and we also see where we stand. And one of the largest consumer of India, so here you can see. Not only the population, whichever the country has highest population, okay, over in India and China. So we used to, you can see the China, so the tons, you can see not even, as I told you, it's not even a kilogram of tons. It's exceeding the near to the 30,000 tons, and then followed by the US, Brazil, Germany, and India. Okay, so we have a lot of livestock, we are exporting it and we are producing it for the prophylactic alone, we are prescribing this antimicrobial agents. So what happens, this antimicrobial agents, it is found in the excretory, it reaches the soil. So the soil contains numerous microorganisms and bacteria. So this sun-sensitive bacterium also become resistant because of this pressure of this antimicrobial agents in the soil. Okay. So initially what happens when they, as soon as they find out the penicillin, they inject to the patients. After that, what happened, they used to collect the urine from the patient, and then they extract again the antibiotics from the urine, and they go for a treatment. Means that it's a purification. Means what I'm saying here, the excretory contain the antimicrobial agents. That is my point here. So when you use consume tons and tons of antimicrobes, it reaches one, it reaches the soil. It will remain under soil, it will remain under water, and all the sewage bodies, and whichever the microbes, you all know that since you are a microbiologist, the soil contains numerous kind of microorganisms. That microorganisms become, especially I can find here, the bacteria become resistant to the antibiotic. Okay. The consequences. So misuse. So the overuse, misuse, and improper use of these antibiotics We cannot blame any the developing countries. So most of the countries, what happens, and especially the developing countries and underdeveloping countries, over counter means that, for example, a patient got infected. So the patient must go to the clinician must do the diagnosis. After the diagnosis, based on the the antibiotic sensitivity report, the clinician must prescribe the antibodies to the patient. But it's not happening. What happens? The complete process is stopped, and then the first process, the clinician, the patient goes to directly the pharmacist, and he is getting the antibiotics. The pharmacist doesn't know that what the patient got infected, whether it's a gram-negative or gram-positive. He doesn't know that, and simply also he is prescribing last resort antibody. That is the problem here. Okay, not even the first line and second line drugs. He is simply directly prescribing, rather than spending 1 rupees for the treatment cost. He is just prescribing for 15 to 20 rupees. Even if you go to police station, but police station they are not prescribed. But even if you go with the carbapenem, just cost 15 to 20 rupees per dose. Okay. So it's usually useless drug. So when the patient, he also, what happens when he get it from the pharmacist and he not continue it, he will stop it in between. If you not continue the full course. So what they should know, if the patient, whoever in the world, whoever got infected, first go to the clinician, basically the clinician, see the clinician, and then the clinician must, I am also requesting the clinician that don't prescribe without diagnosis the patient sample. Okay. First get the patient history, and then there are some they took some data that which country is spending more time with the patient, which country clinicians spending more time with the patients, the Sweden. Okay, they're spending nearly 20 to 26 minutes to the patients, but when you come to the India, we are just spending 1 to 1 minute, 1 to 1.5 minutes. Okay, just imagine, within 1 to 1.5 minutes, it's all an average throughout India. Okay, really it's not enough. We should get all passengers history, where he went, what kind of food he took, where, what was the geographic locations, what was the epidemic situation of the particular thing. He doesn't know that, but at least they should know that with the passenger history. And as soon as they meet the patient, get the history, and then go for a diagnosis of the samples, and then find out what kind of bacterium or microbes he got infected with. Then you go with the, start with the first line drugs. Okay, don't go with the even second line. Okay? Start with first line drugs. You know the antibody sensitivity pattern report in your hand. Based on that, you prescribe the antibody. After that, the patient, give the prescription to the patient. The patient goes to the pharmacist. And the pharmacist, okay, there what happens? The patient insisting the pharmacist to give only 50% of the drug what he prescribed. Can you accept this? It's not possible. Okay, so the clinician did his duty properly. He got the sample, the diagnosis, the samples, and then he forgot to know that the patient got infected with the bacterium. The bacterium can be killed with the first line drugs. He prescribed the antibiotics, but the patient's, what happens, he never prescribed 100% of the drugs what he prescribed, and he went for a 50%. For example, for 10 days, he prescribed for 10 days. He bought for 5 days. And went to home. He just continued 2 days. After 3 days, he left. The full course is not completed. Okay, rather than taking 5 days, rather than taking 10 days, he bought only 5 days and he took only 2 days. He may feel quite good. Then he left. What happened? The bacterium becomes not start resistant because it's a low power. No, means that it's not adequate antibiotics which is present in his body. Therefore, what happens? Low pressure of antibiotics in the bacterium becomes start to resistance, and the patient gets secondary infections, or the same bacterium again giving the infection to the patients. Okay, when he go to the same doctors, he knows that, but what he decide is that doctor is not lucky doctor, I should go to some other doctor. So what he present, he starts with the broad spectrum antimicrobe. Okay, means that the last resort. So this is what happening. Okay, so the problem starts with the people must aware. So because of this, the consequences of misuse of antibiotics. Okay. So as I pointed out, the prescription of antibiotics for viral infections, obviously the antibiotics won't work for viral infections. For example, this is the current situation. Everyone get a viral infection. For that, if you prescribe antibiotics, you will never and ever kill the viruses. Okay. And rather, it kills your normal flora, which is present in your body. So in frequent prescription of broad spectrum antibiotics, you should not prescribe another broad spectrum antibiotics, and inadequate use of the patient. So there is a concept, overuse, misuse, improper use of antibiotics, it become resistant. We lost all available antibodies in the world. Okay. So there is three terms. One is called the MDR. So everyone would have known that MDR, multi-drug resistant bacteria. This is a non-susceptible to at least one agent in 3 or more antimicrobial categories. And then extensive drug resistance, XDR. Non-susceptibility to at least one agent in all but 2 or fewer antimicrobial categories. And then pan-drug resistance. So non-susceptibility to all agents in all categories. Okay. Here I can say this PDR. PDR is a, the bacterium is called superbugs. Once the bacterium resistant to all available antibiotics in the world, it is called superbug. So this, here I'm pointing out the superbug is worse than the cancer, AIDS, and COVID, all etc. Okay, I can say that because we don't have any new antibiotics in our hand, we can't save the patient. So the PDR is very important. When you find out, you should be very careful. So the WHO, World Health Organization, priority pathogen list. They announced the PRPPL, priority pathogen list, in the year 2017. So they classed into 3. One is critical, high, and medium. So the critical, in the sense, if you find out Acinetobacter baumannii, carbapenem resistance. The Pseudomonas aeruginosa, carbapenem resistance. And the Enterobacteriaceae, carbapenem resistance. And third generation cephalosporin. These are critical. If you find from the patients, you should be very careful. And then high, the Enterococcus faecium and the vancomycin resistance. Staphylococcus aureus, especially methicillin resistant staph aureus, okay, and Helicobacter pylori and Campylobacter, Salmonella species, Neisseria gonorrhoeae. So these are the high priority, and then medium priority, okay. So the medium priority, Streptococcus pneumoniae, Haemophilus, and then the Shigella. These are the medium. So they already classified. And from Indian side, our Indian priority pathogen list for our well, our you know, health ministry, our ICMR, they released our priority pathogen list, okay. So the critical priority, the Enterobacteriaceae with carbapenem resistance, Tiacycline and colistin. So these 3 are the last resort antibodies in the world. There is no antibodies after this. Please keep in mind that these 3 are the last resort antibodies. And after that, non-fermenting bacteria, again the carbapenem and colistin resistance. Okay, the high priority. Staphylococcus aureus, MRSA, and then the Enterococcus, and then Salmonella species. These are high priority and medium priority. So the Streptococcus pneumoniae, Staphylococcus, Shigella, Haemophilus, and Neisseria meningitis. So these are the medium priority. So the microbial is whoever the practicing it, whoever having a laboratory, kindly keep in mind that these Indian PPL and the World Health Organization priority pathogen list, you should follow, or definitely we will be in a very trouble. So the hospital acquired infections playing a major role now. Not only, you know, the after the COVID, we pumped so many antibodies to the patients. So those all the antibodies reaches the environment. This in the environment. So it gives the way, the power, the way to become a resistance, the higher percentage when compared with the previous COVID cases. Okay, we have a paper, I'll show you in a letter. So the antibody resistance, why it's a global concern. So okay, so as I pointed out, there is no alternate available at this case and approved alternatives at present. That is what it's the biggest way. So when you prescribe antibodies, when you know it kills only the sensitive, it will not kill the resistant one. So the resistant one transfer its genes to the sensitive bacteria. The horizontal gene transformation of the resistant genes. Okay, so it's simply transfer it one bacterium to other bacterium. So the factors. What are the factors that lead to high hospital acquired infection bird birds? Inadequate emergency cleaning, poor infrastructure, insufficient equipment, and you know. Understaffing, overcrowding, and scarce knowledge, you know, this of application of infection control, and the inappropriate of use of antibiotics, and lack of national and local guidance and policy. This is very important. So the government has already announced a national action plan. Okay, how the clinical microbes must act. What are they? You know, how they should go with that. Okay, if you are loosened, definitely will be in a trouble. You can see here the return to the post antibiotic era. So without, if you don't have antibodies in your hand, in your left hand, you cannot take that knife in your right hand, especially for the clinicians. Okay, they are the patients, those who want a major surgery, and then hip replacement, and then the cancer chemotherapy, and then organ transplantation, and preterm infants. So this, all this, when you want to take a knife in your hand, you must have great antibodies with your left hand. Okay, otherwise, don't take the knife, or else the patient will, you will lose the patient. Because what happens, when you go for a, you know, operations, the wound should cure. So when the pathogenic bacterium is waiting with the called as superbug. So you cannot treat it. So that is what I'm saying. You can see here 10 years from now, the bacterium like this, sensitive, now completely resistant. So this is the current situation. So most of them. So now the world, the even the WHO and CDC, FDA, everyone are worrying about this antibiotic resistance. The end of miracle drugs. Yes, obviously, end of it's going to end. Already end. So it's pretty. We must be very, very be careful. So what we did, so the characterization of carbapenem resistance gram negative bacteria from Tamil Nadu, we just started the samples and identified. So our results confirm the dissemination of New Delhi metallurgical alchemists and the emergence of oxide on ethiopian alchemists among gram negative bacterium in South India. Okay, note the point. So this study showed the emergence of NDM producers in clinical assays of enterobacter pharmacy. So this is a new report. Okay, the enterobacter armature and then the prevalence category. These two bacteria harboring the NDM. This is the new report. We have been finding out the E. coli, Klebsiella and other things, but this is the first report of enterobacter and then the prevalence. This is means that it's high alarming. It's going to spread its own counterpart. Next study, Colchicine Sulfate community of gram-negative clinical isolates from Tamil Nadu, India. So our studies, okay. Indicate the emergence of colchicine resistance in isolates from clinical samples among different group of gram-negative organisms. Okay, the resistance of both carbapenem and colchicine actuates in Tamil Nadu, and the dissemination of colchicine resistance is going to huge clinical problem in future. Okay, this is the whole report, 16 report. Okay, so this is the 17. So we published in the Journal of Medical Microbiology. So our study now showed that there was a high prevalence of carbapenem and colchicine resistance in Tamil Nadu. We report the first time the carbapenem resistant genes NDM1 and OXA33 were carried by class 1 indigram. So that is, please note it. The class, we just find out whether the gene cassette, you know, the indigrams, that is the class 1, class 2, and class 3 indigrams, you know, the class type is there. So this present in the class 1 indigram, especially this NDM1 OXA33 gene. Once this gene is present in the class, you know, the class 1 indigram, it transferred resistance to other bacterium. Once it transferred resistance, it confirmedly the resistant gene transferred to other bacterium. That bacterium also directly become a last resort antibiotic resistant bacteria. Means that it's a problematic. So we published in the year of 2017. So after that, so many we published in a Journal of Antimicrobial Chemotherapy from the British Society for Antimicrobial Chemotherapy, and there also we talked about this carbapenem colchicine. So what is the ongoing research in AMR? So we are doing the prevalence and molecular characterization of antibiotic resistance gram-negative and gram-positive bacteria and the antibiotic resistance cephalosporin carbapenem colchicine tricyclic phage therapy and alternative cure, isolation and identification of antibiotic resistant bacteria from poultry and animal samples. We not only limiting ourselves with the clinical samples, we also extend our sampling with the environment and poultry. Okay, so poultry we are using, you know, in Tamil Nadu we are using so many tons of antibiotics for prophylactic that reaches the soils. From that we did the samples and we got an excellent result that there is a GPC, gram positive bacterium transferred resistant GMB. This is the first report and also it is already communicated. So in our laboratory, so we have total of clinical bacterial isolate of 2000 plus clinical samples we have. So from blood itself, we have found urine, pus, fecal, bronchial, and organism isolated equally Klebsiella, Pseudomonas aeruginosa, Acinetobacter, Proteus, Salmonella, Enterobacter, Staphylococcus, and Streptococcus. So these are the different genuses, and then the total number of isolates in our laboratory we host, which is already in our lab. So as soon as we received the samples and identified the bacterium, we did sickness RNA sequence for all the bacterium, and then we also sequenced the indigrants, whether the bacterium in the contain the class 1 integrants or class 2, whether it contains the resistance or not, whether it's transferring or not. We are going to check it. So what we do, the first step in our laboratory, so as soon as we see the clinical samples, from the clinical samples, I identify the isolate. After that, we go. Sensitive pattern on the first another top resistant the thing. So you all know that the antibody distribution test. And once again, I want to just, is my audio is fine? Shall I continue?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Yes, thank you. So the antibiotic distribution test, so we go after that, we go for a MIC. We do both broth and agar dilutions. Okay, all we also follow the ECOS, CLS, and FDA. Okay, but without the, and also BSAC. Okay, there is a, there are, these people are the standard setters of the antibiotics in the world. So the MIC we use for protection, meropenem, colistin, gentamicin, tricyclin. Also, we use MIC by E-strips. Okay, so the molecular studies. So far, we have just told you the phenotypic. Here, the genotypic studies, especially the molecular studies. We do the DNA isolation and the plasmid DNA isolation. Okay. And also, we report the presence of transferable plasmid bone NDM1 gene in SNAP theory from poultry samples from the first time. Okay, it is already communicated. You can see each and every background has more than 5 or 6, 2 or 3. You can see the, this is the highest number of plasmids. Okay, these are, I just did this in my PhD. This is my result. You can see here, most of the okay bacterium contains, but this here 1, 2, 3, 4 doesn't contain any plasmid, but rest of the other bacterium contains so many plasmids, especially you can see the 11 and then the 32, okay, so many plasmids, and then 21, these are the plasmids. Imagine this many plasmids contained in a particular bacterium. So we also do the 16S RNA amplification, the total size of the gene is 1500 base pair. And then amplification of integrants. So as I told you, they reported the presence of plasmid integrants, gene class ingredients carrying the NDM1 and ALPSA. So these are the integrants. And amplification of GTXM gene. So we did a multiple spacer and we find out there's a three different genes. One is a 205 base pair, and then 415 base pair, and 552 base pair. In a cepotaxin, there is a group 1, group 2, group 24, 25. There are five different classes of cepotaxin in a the resistance. There are more than the two. We just amplified it. So you can see here the amplification of NDM gene, so neutrally metal-chemist gene. It's totally powered, you know, it's a base pair of 721 base pair. And then the airy pattern, we just did. Since we have a different geographical regions of the isolate, we just map with whether the unique resistant bacterium is sharing the same homology or not. We did this airy pattern. So and then so these are the resistant genes we are focusing and amplifying it. So far, we have amplified 79 cepotaxin and 38 NDM1 and 32 oxo-48 like and 12 imipenem and 1 DAM1. So this DAM1, it's we found out from the hospital doorknob. Just imagine hospital doorknob. We just have the samples and then we identify the bacterium and then we gone for a sequencing and unluckily, but luckily for result, unluckily for our society, the DAM1 was present in the hospital doorknob. And then just one and mechanism amplified 58 from the medicine resistance that variant. So the whichever the gene we amplify, we sequence, it should be submitted to the NCP. So far we have submitted all most of the resistant gene 6S integrants. And also we did 15 whole genome sequencing of bacteriophages. Also we are doing the 10 different bacteria that and it is under process. Going to reach the South Korea very soon. We are doing the work. So far we were discussing about the AMR. I hope you all know the consequences of AMR, and especially we can say MDR, XDR, and PDR. So once the patient is infected with PDR, there is no other way. We should find out the alternate therapy. So that is what, and we are just past 15 years. I'm 15 years before itself. I just predicted and start to work on this bacteriophage therapy, and now. There are some facts that they are addressing, and that we can go for antibiotics, probiotics, vaccines, phage therapy, and antimicrobial peptides. Okay, so I'm just focused only. I just skipped all other some alternative. I just find only the phage therapy. Okay, so we were using 100 years before we were using these bacteriophages, but after as soon as we find out the penicillin, and we stop using a bacteriophages. The problem. Instead, they were using it, but still there are, and we will just going to tell you which other countries are using at present. So here, a phage, now phage is nothing but bacteriophage is a viruses that it recognizes bacteria as a food. Okay, it belongs. It depends on the bacteria, especially the specific bacteria. It do not kill any other type of bacteria. Okay, so the bacteriophages is a viruses. It may be. Okay, it also it's distributed in all the locations. Okay, it is present in everywhere, and more than it has 100 different phage species, and at least 10 phages for each bacterium is present already. The ICTV already placed the tailed bacteriophages under the cadaverids. These cadaverids has different type of families, Myoidae, Cypripedae, and Podoidae. So the bacteriophages may contain the DNA or RNA. So completely covered the protein coat, okay, of the nucleic acids. And the size is maybe the 100 nanometer. And you can see the Cypripedae, it's a long contractile. Okay. And then here the Myoidae is a short contractile, and there is no there is no contractile tail, only the protein coat. So these three are used to for the bacteriophage therapy. So in bacteriophage, there is a the fate of phages. There is a life cycle. There's a two type of life cycle. One is a lytic and lysogenic life cycle. So lytic, you all would have studied in your theory itself, the lytic and lysogenic. So lytic, what happens as soon as the phages, okay, sit on the surface of the bacteria. We are here. We are simply saying it is sit, but it has a receptor. The phages has a receptor. And the bacterium also, the surface, the cell, the surface cells, cell wall contain a different receptor. Once it match, it will sit, or else it will not sit. Okay, means that it requires specific receptors to sit on a bacterium. That is why this is genus specific, genus and species strain specific. Okay, so after that, it inject the genetic material, and the genetic material hijack the bacterial enzymes, and then it develop its own progeny, and then burst the cells out, and then again, it go on sit on the other bacterium. So like that, like it calls autodosing, we can say here. But in the lysogenic, what happens? It integrates into the bacteria, and then the bacterial contains the phage, the genome. It what happens? It's called as temperate. Both the cycles. The temperate phages can follow the both the cycles, and then the rest what happens? It continues the cycle. And sometimes in future, what happens? It may emerge as a bacteriophages from this cycle, but it won't happen. But we are focused here for bacteriophage therapy. We are using only the lytic bacteriophage. Okay. So the phage therapy history. There is a scientist called Hankin. See, before the history, I'm just giving you some specific information related to that. So there is a in the world, there is a country called Georgia still using this bacteriophage therapy. After the discovery of penicillin, they started using the bacteriophages. But still, there is a country in the world called Georgia. They are still using the bacteriophages and treating the patients. Okay. And Western, still the FDA is not approved, but they approved only for the food. To process in the food like listeria. And there is a patient called Thomas Patterson. Okay, from the US, he got infected with the. The pancreatitis and bacterium in Egypt. They went for some excursion in Egypt. So there he got infected, and he is sickened, and he can't walk. He went to the last stages, and they moved him to the US. They find out the Thomas Patterson, he got infected with the last drug result antibiotic, and then they got a pre-approval from the FDA to use the phages for this patient. And luckily, what happens? He went to coma. Okay, he went to coma, and then his wife, she's Stephanie. She wrote a book. The perfect predator. He's available in Amazon too. She released the book from she came to New Delhi. She released the book too, and the person, he survived, and also there is other girl. She also survived because of the cystic fibrosis. She's going to lose his life, but. They tried with the many scientists, and then they work together, and they find out the microbacterium left free, and then they go for the phage treatment. They record it. So these are the few life success stories. The scientist called this 1996, the Ernest Hanbury Hankin. So he find out that there is something in our river, the Indian River. So they find out, okay, but he's been not named because of he get enough funding, and he stopped it. After that, Frederick Tuart, 1877 and 1950, he is a British bacteriologist. He also started interestingly work on this, but what happens because of the World War, he cannot continue this. Because the World War, there will be a sort of funding, and he cannot continue. And then after that, Felix D. Harrell, 1873 to 1949, he discovered that there is a bacterium that is killing it, and he only named it. He only took to second next level. Okay, and also. They started a Yale Institute, they opened in Tbilisi, Georgia. So he's a man, he's continued, but anyhow, the both Hanbury and then the Frederick Tewitt and then the Felicity Herald, these three heroes, they initiated the bacteriophages phase for to tackle this bacterial infections. So why it's a phage therapy? So the antibiotic resistance, we are focusing the, you know, the phage therapy because of the antibiotic resistance. Not only the antibiotic resistance, as I pointed out, there is a three categories: multi-drug resistance, extreme drug resistance, pan-drug resistance. So once the patient is infected with this MDR, and obviously, you know, and the next chances may get with the PDR. Okay, so we, after that, there won't be enough, you know, the treatment option. That is why we should focus on this after phage therapy. So the here the prerequisite to go with the prerequisite for phage therapy. The phage therapy should not be attempted before the biology of the therapeutic phase is well understood. Okay, when you identify the bacteriophages, it should be identified completely. And then phage preparation should meet all the safety requirements. And the phage preparation should contain infective phage particles, and then the phage receptor should be known. Okay, as I told you, the receptor, the bacteriophage has a receptor, and it will not see any other, it will not kill, okay, it will not see any kind of other bacterium. It just bind only the specific genus, species, and strains. Okay, so where can you find these bacteriophages? So that in humans and animal intestine, in running water, and then the soil, effluent of sweat, sealed from carcass, and identified a community of DNA viruses, most of which were identified as bacteriophages from CSF. As I told you, our CSF, cerebral spinal fluid, contained the bacteriophages. They identify the DNA of the viruses. Okay, and this is the 2019, and they already in about their abstract is already published. So means that it is present in our gut itself, in our water, the sewage, and soil, everywhere is present. Okay, so how to use this therapy? Orally, we can go topically on infected wounds. Application in liquid from the possible, so preferably represented vials. Injection is rarely used. Okay. So what are we doing? So actually, isolation of bacteriophages against antibiotic resistant bacteria, especially E. coli, Klebsiella pneumoniae, Acinetobacter baumannii, Pseudomonas aeruginosa, Enterobacter cloacae, Staphylococcus aureus, Mycobacter spagmatis and tuberculosis, and Vibrio parasymptomatics, Citrobacter, Pseudomonas maltophilia, Elizabeth kingia. So this, in addition to this, we also included a few genuses and we are working on it. Okay. So that is our target. We used to isolate the bacteriophages for maximum pathogenic bacterium in the whichever is available in our country. So the step, okay, the methodology. So each and every step consumes so many minutes. So I'm just giving you a simple way how to do that. So isolation, nothing but we are just collecting the samples and then go for isolation of bacteriophages. And plaque assay. So whether the plaque assay is nothing but it kills our surrounding. When you keep a disc of antibodies, if you think of it, there will be some inhibition zone like that. The same when you can see the plaque assay. Okay, and then host range. So how many hosts, you know, it kills. That is the host. And then purification of the bacteriophages and stability. That is very important. And then you go for a TEM analysis, transmission ultramicroscope, and then one step growth curve for the life cycle of the bacteriophages and the in vitro activity, whether it kills. Okay, in vitro, and then the DNA isolation and genome analysis. And then we go for a phage cocktail, in vivo study, Brax moth larvae and G prophage. Okay. So there are so many methods there, and is really an hour is really not enough to completely cover that. That's why I'm just keep on going on. So the bacteriophage isolation against the bacteria. So we do go with the double agar overlay. You can see here, this is a plaque forming. Okay, this light color, it's a bacteria, and then this is a spot. Okay, this is the bacteriophages. It's a plaque formation. What happens? It starts killing it. Okay, if you see after 6 or 8 hours, even after 12 hours, you can see these plaque formations. And when you keep on, you know, for example, keep on incubating it after 2 or 3 days, completely the bacteriophages kills all the bacterium, and finally you will not find any bacterium here. And finally, you may ask me that what will happen? Obviously, it will die, because if it didn't find out the host, it will automatically die. So we already characterized the bacteriophages. There is a 4 bacteriophages: EC131 PSS, KP326 PSS, and EL140 PSS, and AB220 PSS. This is the thing. Different nomenclature we have given for the bacteriophages. So that because of the TEM analysis, and we find out the viruses, you know, the bacteriophages belongs to Meyerviridae, and this belongs to Spiroviridae, and then the EL140 belongs to Meyerviridae, and 220 belongs to Odoviridae. So DNA, the size 18,000 base pair, and 3 to 6 belongs to 20,000 base pair, and 140 the 40,000 base pair, and the 220 the 38,000 base pair. So the protein variant, and then the mutation frequency. So we check the mutation, you know, how it mutate when it reaches the host. So 1.1 plus or minus 0.5 into 10^7 range, it become a mutation for all other things. Okay. And the absorption velocity, so 1.2 in 10^-9, and this rest is 1.8, here is 2.0 and 1.9. So almost all same, but similar 0.4 is a variant. And then latency period, so latency period nothing but it takes 25 minutes to completely assemble it. Okay. So for example, minimum time among the four bacteriophages, this 2 to 0 takes within a 15 minutes it comes out. The burst takes nothing but single bacteriophages when it sent to the bacteria, and when it bursts, okay, when it bursts out, it releases nearly 130 bacteriophages from one bacterium. The virus is coming from 130, and also the 1 to 6 comes 145. The highest is here 175 bacteriophages comes from the bacteria. Okay, the pH studies. The stability is very important when we go for a phage therapy. Treatment options, the phages must have a good stability of when we check it, the least is 4 and highest is 11. Okay, here the least is 5.5, the highest is 11. So almost our human body is a 7, it's a neutral pH, 7.5. So it should work. Even if it goes 4, the phages will work. The temperature is 55 degrees, and 50 and 45. So we also focus on the stability is very important when you catch any bacteriophage. Okay, so the total number of bacteriophages we isolated so far. So the equally we have 13 bacteriophages we isolated from the Ganges rivers, and then the pneumonia, Clostridium pneumonia, we have 3, and Pseudomonas aeruginosa 4, and Acinetobacter baumannii 2, and Enterobacter cloacae and Proteus mirabilis. So we don't have any phages for the Proteus mirabilis. And Serratia we have 1, Salmonella 11, and Staph aureus 7. Acetobacter 2 and the Enterobacter 4 and then Mycobacter pseudomonas 7. So we are focusing on isolation of different kind of bacteriophages for the hosts. So when we did the whole genome sequencing of our bacteriophages, it just has a great similarity with the already submitted one. Okay, means that we didn't gone for wrong, like it has a great homology. There are some 5-10 percentage difference, but it should be there. It's from some European country and it's from our own. Oh, nice way. So what we did was we tried to identify and discriminate.
Thank you very much, sir, for such an informative session.
Ma'am, I'm sorry. Yeah, no problem. I have some questions. Will I continue?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, please. Yeah. So we try to find out whether the bacteriophages, you know, to check with the animal studies, but it's too costly. That's why what we decided was we should go with a small animal model. That is what we decided with the G. mananala. So the Galerian mananala is a back smart. So it never recovered because for ethical approval to work with this, and also it's a good already model to do this, and that is what also it resembles and gives like a human the immunity. That is what it has the similarity to the vertebrate immune responses. That is what we selected, and we decide this experiment setup in the 4-day setup: set 1, set 2, set 3, and set 4. The set 1 is a control on saline alone, and then set 2 is a control on bacteria alone, and set 3 is a phage alone, and test 4. Now we further divide into single dose and multi dose. And the single dose, we just given 10^8 CFE per ml, and then the multi dose, you know, here only the 0 hour, but here we just divided into 0 hour, 6 hour, 12 hour, 18 hour, 24 hour. Okay. So this is the live and healthy one, say white creaming color. This is a dead one, and we have to inject this phage suspension in the last left colon, because if you go with this layer, what happens, you will be disturbed the stomach and the worm will die. That is what we have given. So this is the activity of E. coli phage for a single dose. What happens? So after 96 hours, the worm, you know, this it killed it. Okay. The because the dosage is not enough. Also after 48 hours, the bacteria is killed, because pathogenic bacteria will kill the worm. Also, when we treated with single doses, there is no 100% result we got. And also, we gone for a multi-doses. So when we gone for a multi-doses, okay, we got excellent result. Also, we enumerated the bacterium from the dose 1, 2, 3, and finally dose 3 and dose 4, we did not find any pathogenic bacterium present in the worm. Means that our bacteriophages killed completely the bacteria. And we again we checked with the clusterophages, the same result we got with the 96 hours, the activity is released and killed. And we again tried with the multi-doses, and when you go for a multi-doses, we got excellent result that after the doses 3, but the doses 2, still there is some 10 to the power of 2 bacterium was found, and when we tried with the doses 3 and doses 4, it completely drastically reduced, and we got an excellent result. The same for enterobacterium we did, and the multi-doses when we gone, see here interestingly, until the doses 3, there is a bacterium which is present, and doses 4, there is no bacterium which is present. And we tried with the multi doses, it's a cocktail. We compared all the four different bacteriophages, and also we compared four different bacterium and the injected to the Galerium manella. And what happens here, surprisingly, we got the growth until the four doses four, and surprisingly, when we increase the doses for five, for example, if a patient got infected with multiple infections, we can choose this cocktail phages. Okay, so we can really save the patients even if they got infected with four different clinical pathogens. Okay, then this is what our result. So the uniqueness of our study is freeze drying and then the cocktail. The freeze drying nothing but your patient infected with the US and if we want to send the bacteriophages, if you send through the liquid, it cannot be possible. So it should be freeze. Okay, so already available life phase condition is not that much stable. And it won't, give the high titer value. But I'll show you the result in the end. And this is the paper we published in secondary bacterial infections during pulmonary viral diseases. The phage therapies as alternatives to antibiotics. We just put in a question mark. And then now the FDA allows phage therapy for COVID patients. This is our success of our review. And also, we have chosen now what happens when you go with the antibiotics and finally you will definitely and lose the patients, now the death like you. But when you go with the phage therapy in late 11, you can really save the patient. That is what our one of our Chinese collaborators, he's from Germany. He reported when he tweeted. So he finally he just removed the question mark, and now the FDA allowed us and doing this. And other studies our endolysis, we are trying to cloning the whichever we sequence for especially whole genome. We design a primer for endolysin and then we amplify. Now we are we are extracting the protein from the endolysin and we are getting a good result with that. And this is another study, some metagenomic approach, whether the phageome which is present in the mother and the child. We already did the study with whether the bacterium is transferring from the mother to the child. So from that we took a data and we find out excellent result that all the family, whichever we have shown, it is present in the human, the mother and then child, baby. We just started the school samples and then we analyze the metagenome and then find out this bacteriophage is present in the both mother and the child. Okay, it's not 100%, but it has really 50-60% of the bacteriophage to the child. So these are the few research papers we published in the Frontiers, BMC and the past one. And then scientific reports, this is the unique result we patented. Means that the all available life phase conditions is not up to the level. That is what we just improve the life phase condition, but especially bacteriophages. For example, if you want to send a bacteriophage to the US or Canada or anywhere, so the current available method, you can send it, but that should be again cultured and then purified and then injected to the patient. But what we did was we just used the pharmaceutically approved excipients and then we. And also the still we are maintaining the powder of the bacteriophage is giving you the 98% of the recovery, and it is really not required to go for second culturing and then purification. As soon as it reaches to the spot, that can be the mixture of the saline and can be injected to the patient lively. It won't cause anything, and also it works. That is what we went for a patent. It is already patent is published. So this is the live example. Since I don't have enough time to share this. And conclusion, I can say here, rather than wasting of time with the antibiotics for especially the XTR, the pathogens, directly we can go with the bacteriophage therapy. And at present, the government of India, there is no approval from the FDA. That's why if the patient is infected with PDR, okay, anyway, he or she is going to die. to other conditions based on the two clinical doctors of India, registered clinical doctors with the ethical approval of the hospital and the DCGI permission, we can go with the phase therapy to tackle the the save the patients. Okay. So this is, we have a society called the Society for Bacteriophage Research and Therapy in India. We started from Baskin University. After that, see, from in India, I am the first to conducted the international conference. She's a phase queen. All the women can recommend her. She's a real role model. She's still age of running 83. Okay. Still we used to communicate. I think she given a talk in Pune other colleges. We can have her, and also we welcome you all to become a life member of our society. And in India, we have other NGO called Indian Initiative for Management of Antibiotic Resistance. Not only doing the research, also we are doing the social service of, we are creating awareness to the people that to create awareness of how to use this antimicrobial agent. Okay. The problem is the people doesn't know what is antibiotics. Okay. So here and this, I'm serving as a delegate to the conference organized by the Government of India. And then this is the brochures, awareness brochures. We made it in 9 different languages around India. And India's first awareness campaign we conducted. You can see here, this is the map. We just covered almost almost the complete our nations, okay, throughout our campaign. So how to use these antibiotics, what is the consequences of antibiotics. We just covered all, even the school children too. And we made some script and with the different languages, 9 different languages, and on the broadcasters around 450 radio stations around India at the time. So this is my research lab. You all welcome to my lab whenever you are free. And then this is my collaborations around the globe. And my scholar, he got a Young Scientist Award for the stage work. And then this is a very recent Times of India publication 2021. So for our stage work. So thank you so much. Since I don't have enough time for covering complete things, but almost I have covered all the things. So if you have any doubt, please ask me. I'm ready to answer all your questions. Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you so much, sir, for such an informative session and for introducing the alternative therapy of phage therapy for antibiotic resistant microorganisms. Students, the session is open for question answers. So students who have questions can ask, sir.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes, please.
Yes, sir. Thank you for such an enlightening session. Sir, I have a very small doubt. Sir, in slide number 16, you wrote a statement that the prescription of antibiotics for viral infection is the cause for one of the leading causes for developing antibiotic resistance. So, sir, as per we have been taught in our medical microbiology lecture that during viral infection, somewhere the body is becoming immunocompromised. And then some opportunistic pathogen are causing secondary infection. So to avoid that, the antibiotics have been administered. So if it is a cause for antibiotic resistant, if such practices are cause for antibiotic resistant, then what type of approaches should a medical practitioner should use to replace the antibiotics?
So what happens, I'm just pointed out that that is one of the causes, and also if this goes with the proper prescription, not in problem for us. Okay, this there and this pointed out that it is a over the counter. Okay, over the counter. Also the we are prescribing it, and because of that we are losing it. Okay, since secondary opportunity pathogen, we cannot stop it. Every process, but it is 90% is a prophylactic. But we are just focusing only 10%. But 90% we are losing the antimicrobial agents. Okay, that is what we are pointing out. But anyhow, when the patient, when you get the samples from the diagnostic, the ward or something, for the diagnostic laboratory, you will be finding out what kind of bacterium the patient got infected, and then we can go accordingly. Okay, it's not required to go with the prophylactic always. Is it okay, Vivek? Sorry, it's not a...
Yes, sir. Thank you.
You're muted. Okay. Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Yes. Any more questions, students?
Ankita wants to ask.
Sir, I had a question.
Yes, yes, Ekta, please.
So when we are doing plating to isolate phages, how do we distinguish between lytic and lysogenic?
So when you start working on this phages, you must know the clear plaque formation, okay? There's not be any hazy, like a bullseye like that, okay? So when you choose the bullseye, it will be the lysogenic. Always chooses the clear, mirror, okay? It should be like a mirror. The media should be like, look, you should see the media should be clear, and then there should not be any hazy or any bullseye formations on a plaque. So that is very important.
Okay, so plaque morphology can tell us what type it is.
Yes, yes. Even we published the paper, the plaque morphology changes based on the media we use. I think we published a paper, and it's available. It is published in Access Microbiology. I think available. You can go through it. Even if you change the media, it changes the morphology of the plaque.
Yes. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Ekta.
Yes, students. Anybody has a question? Thank you very much, sir, for such an informative session and for answering the queries from the students. We would look forward for much more lectures from your side. Thank you very much for accepting our invitation and for the talk.
Thank you, Dr. Rupali, and thank you, Dr. Ekta, since he invited me. Thank all the organizing team of the Department of Microbiology, especially this conference, complete organizers, management of these institutions, and all the students who participated, and other speakers to this conference. Thank you all. Thank you so much for your excellent invitations. I hope we'll meet you all in person at the time permits. Okay.
Yes.
Thank you all. Thank you so much for your time. Thank you all.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I would now like to invite Ms. Sridhar Pardeshi to continue with the session for the second lecture of today. Ms. Sridhar Pardeshi, madam.
Yes. Thank you so much, ma'am. I hope I'm clearly audible. The next speaker for the session. Okay, the next speaker for the session is Dr. Hemraj Nandanwar, and I'm very pleased to given an opportunity to introduce him. Dr. Nandanwar is a senior principal scientist and professor at Academy of Scientific and Innovative Research. Bioactive screening, clinical microbiology, and drug discovery are his areas, and he's also there at CSIR IM Tech Chandigarh, India. He has done B.Pharm from University Department of Pharmaceutical Sciences, Nagpur University, M.Tech Biotech and Engineering from IIT Kharagpur, PhD in Microbiology from Punjab University, Chandigarh. He has more than 12 years of experience in bioactive screening and antibiotic or adjuvant discovery against escape pathogens. Specific targets in bacterial pathogens such as efflux pump inhibitors, beta-lactamase inhibitors, cell wall active antibiotics, cell penetrating, and antimicrobial peptides. He has actively participated in CSIR's drug discovery network programs and later coordinated the same. He has successfully completed industrial sponsored projects such as in collaboration with DSM Netherlands, PNG Bangalore, Kumar Organic Products Limited, Dhampur Sugar Mill, and other industries for screening for bioactive molecules, enzymes, and inhibitors. At present, he and his team are developing 3 therapeutics for management of antimicrobial resistance, and its preclinical development is underway. His expertise include handling of clinical strains, development of drug candidates from natural resources, screening and validation of natural, synthetic, and semi-synthetic chemical libraries against various drug targets in escape pathogenesis, establishment of assays and their validation for antibiotics or enzyme inhibitors, and preclinical studies of the same. He has 40 international publications to his credits. 4 patents have been granted to Sir. There are 2 book chapters published by him, 3 proof of concepts related to antimicrobial resistance, 3 preclinical developments, and 4 industrial projects. Sir is also guiding PhD students in this area of research. With this brief introduction, I now request Dr. Nandanwar to begin his talk on discovery to development, an antibiotic against gram-negative infections. Dr. Nandanwar, please, sir.
Thank you, Sheetal, for a nice introduction. Actually, my patents are under filing, not granted, actually. Right. So I'm making the correction. Today, I'm sharing my slide.
So you can select the tab present now and share your entire screen.
Actually, that's what I'm doing.
Okay. Yes, sir, we can see your screen.
My screen you can see, but presentation?
No, sir, you'll have to open the presentation.
It is already on the desktop.
Sir, we see the screen that you are watching right now.
Mm-hmm.
So if you like the Google Meet screen.
Mm-hmm.
And yes.
So if you are okay with it, maybe you can share your presentation with me and then I can share.
I think this is okay.
Yes.
This is in PowerPoint mode?
Not yet. The PowerPoint is not there.
Huh.
coming PowerPoint mode? No.
So PowerPoint file is open. We just the slideshow is not. I mean, you can see the slides, but not in slideshow.
Is it okay? No.
No, sir. It is only in the slides mode.
It is coming. Hello.
So still only PPT is visible, not the slideshow.
So probably you can try minimize this and open your presentation.
That I did already, actually.
Okay.
Sir, you can say. So if it's okay with you, maybe you can send me the PPT in PDF format and I can share it for you.
PPT in PDF format?
So, or the PPT itself, either way. So instead of sharing the entire screen, maybe if you could try to share just the tab for the PPT. तर तुमची पीपीटी खाली ओपन असेल ना टास्क बार वरती.
पीपीटी तर ओपन आहे. हॅलो.
हो सर, मग तुम्ही जेव्हा प्रेझेंट नाव करताय तर त्याच्यात इन्स्टेड ऑफ डूइंग युअर एंटायर स्क्रीन मे बी द सेकंड ऑप्शन जस्ट अ विंडो.
युअर एंटायर स्क्रीन, अ विंडो अँड अ टॅब, थ्री ऑप्शन.
सेकंड ऑप्शन सिलेक्ट अ विंडो.
विंडो ठीक आहे.
आणि त्याच्यात ऑप्शन्स मध्ये यू विल सी युअर पीपीटी. In the options that you will see, share an application window, Chrome wants to share the contents of your screen. Tachat you will see your PowerPoint slideshow.
Tachat donach option yetat. Ek window diste ani ek meet you ek hi yete. Ekach window yete. Ani ti share kelyanantar
sir, maybe click on window then instead of the entire screen. Sir, दोन ऑप्शन मधला मग पहिला ऑप्शन चूज केला तर असंच दिसतंय का?
युअर एंटायर स्क्रीन
तेवढा एकच ऑप्शन आहे का सर?
एंटायर स्क्रीन. एंटायर स्क्रीन नंतर हे होत आहे
सर, देन खाली टास्क बार मध्ये तुमच्या पीपीटी वरती क्लिक करा. जेव्हा द एंटायर स्क्रीन इज बीइंग प्रोजेक्टेड जस्ट क्लिक ऑन द पीपीटी इन योर टास्क बार.
एक मिनट, एंटायर स्क्रीन. आता ठीक आहे का, येत आहे का काही? हॅलो.
अजून नाही, अजून नाही सर. Yes, sir. Full screen.
येते
सर, अजून पण गुगल मीटची स्क्रीनच दिसते. हा, आता ओपन झालं. आता फुल स्क्रीन करून.
ठीक आहे.
येस येस, परफेक्ट.
वीस मिनिट गेली त्याच्यात.
दॅट्स फाईन सर.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Ekta. Actually, this is a last moment call, and I said ready, and I said for some other topics for drug repurposing, but Dr. Ekta Kamle, she requested me, whatever you speak, we will accept it. So you need to bear with me, right? So I'm talking about today about this an antibiotic against gram-negative bacteria. Everybody knows about the seriousness of gram-negative bacterial infection, right? And there is not a single new antibiotic except colistin is effective in when this gram-negative infection is very serious, right? So I'm talking about this, our story of discovery, beginning from the screening, getting samples, screening, and further development up to preclinical stage, right? So everybody knows about what is the AMR. This symposium is more about AMR, antimicrobial resistance, and what are the different challenges, how it can be tackled, AMR. So it is not a localized problem, neither from India. It is global problem, and it is consistent problem, and every year it is increasing. COVID pandemic is here. After a few years, probably we will forget about the COVID, but this gram-negative infection is consistent problem, and we need to discover or to find out the way how it can be tackled, right? So in previous era, in golden period of the antibiotic discovery era, every antibiotics was working, those are acting as a silver bullets. So but later what happened, so slowly this resistance has been developed against more or less almost all the antimicrobial agents which were discovered to 1960s. And you can see here how this, for student very easy, for graduate student, how this antibiotic resistance developed. And this is the bug, you can see here, green. This bug cannot responding to the any antibiotics so far discovered are in the clinical practice, right? So what are the reasons why this kind of situation is happening or coming, or we are facing, and what are the sources of AMR, what are the like livestock, poultry. Poultry is the bigger source, and even livestock products. Agriculture, we are using a lot of antibiotics and some other insecticides also. Epidemiology, exposure to resistant infection, contaminated food and environment, misuse of antibiotic. Actually, many people use take antibiotic on the counter, and they don't complete the course of antibiotic. And that basically it is underuse or overuse of antibiotic. Those are the unhygienity in the ICUs, operation theaters, poor sanitation. These are the various causes of this antibiotic resistance. And WHO has prioritized the different bacterial pathogens as a three category, high priority 1, 2, and 3. And most of this gram-negative infection comes under this critical pathogens. And these are the challenges, this is a real challenge to tackle this gram-negative bacterial infection. And these gram-negative pathogens are coming into the kind of escape category of bacterial pathogens. These Klebsiella pneumoniae, Acinetobacter, and E. coli. These are the bacteria which are gram-negative bacteria which are coming under Pseudomonas aeruginosa. These are coming under escape category, including other couple of gram-positive bacteria, Staphylococcus and Enterococcus. You can see these are the various, you can see here how this E. coli affects, and what are the target organs you can see here, and what are the source, for example, E. coli, what are the source from this environment, intestine, and what are the target areas? This is lung and this is kidney. These are it is serious problem. And if we see this country-wise, how much is the burden of this escape pathogens is there? So it's the biggest contribution is in India. So you can see here, this all graphs. So the problem of this bacterial, this escape pathogenesis is severe, serious in India. E. coli, psoriasis, Klebsiella pneumoniae, every pathogens, right? And you can see different classes of antibiotics, which are common antibiotics, which are used in the clinical practice. So more or less every antibiotic, the bacterium has developed the resistance. So we need a better, better health, better environment, and healthy animals. So that is the triad. And one of the way to manage this thing is antibiotic stewardship. And antibiotic stewardship is nothing but the appropriate use of antibacterial, antimicrobial agent. How it can be done, educating the staff, under spray this supporting surveillance of AMR, and using the shortest duration of antibiotic based on the evidence. Most of the time in Indian practice, normally we don't do susceptibility test prior to prescribe the medicine, antibiotic. So this type of practice is done, then appropriate antibiotic, which is really effective against the infection in the patient, that will prevent the resistance against other antibiotic which are not of use for that patient. This kind of practice can be option to manage this problem of AMR. And what are other options in repurposing? I was supposed to talk today on repurposing, but I'm not talking about repurposing today. And repurposing of the FDA-approved drugs, then target-specific novel compound library. We can design the different chemical libraries based on the target. If you know this, the specific target, and that is the novel and valid drug target in the bacteria, and that is not in the host, so that we can target, and we can design this based on the bioinformatics tools. We can design the different chemical compounds and their analogs for the inhibition. If it is enzyme, it can be inhibitors. Combination of more than, when you see these days, if you go to the counter of medical shop, you will see most of the prescription, most of this formulation are in the combination of one or two, combination of two or three antibiotics. So these are working in synergy of each other, and they are synergizing the effect, and they are managing the infection. Then final option is the finding new antibiotic or inhibitor with novel mode of action. That is the ultimate thing, and we are going to talk about this thing only. Normally people say there is nothing in discovery, and it is difficult, it is not possible, impossible. So a lot of negativities are there about discovery. Even MNC and most of the MNCs are not investing in new drug development or new antibiotic development, because the failure rate is high and investment is also high. So they are not taking any risk. But as a R&D point of view, as a researcher, as a student, or scholars, so to avoid this kind of negativity, if you see these kind of articles, there are hopes, right? So there are several antibiotics in the discovery, and some up in the preclinical phase, and some are only in the discovery. Maybe they could not go through preclinical or clinical phase, maybe because of some reasons of toxicity or some pharmacokinetic format, PKPD reasons. So there are the discoveries in recent, and those discoveries are published in very reputed journal of our science, life sciences, Nature, Cell, right? So what we do in our group in the Institute of Microbial Technology, we work on different aspects of this management of escape pathogenesis. We look for enzyme inhibitors, kind of beta-lactamase inhibitor also, and recently we are working on beta-lactamase MBL inhibitor, and we have filed recently a patent also. So we will be, in a couple of years, that will come in the preclinical studies. And another thing, efflux, we have very well established our research in efflux pump inhibitors for inhibiting the active efflux pumps. These are membrane protein, and these are not allowing this antibiotic to stay inside, and they are just expelling out, and this inhibitor are taking care of that extrusion of antibiotics from the body. Self-penetrating peptide is another concept. It's a kind of antimicrobial peptide, but they have a property of helping this antibiotic to get into the cytoplasm. So they are help in synergy of this FDA approved antibiotics. If we combine this cell kind of a self-penetrating peptide, it works. Although the antibiotic which are absolute, or even the resistance has been developed, those can be again reused by using the enhancing their effect with self-penetrating peptide, cell wall active antibiotics. So what is the sources of our what is the food for our research? It is basically natural habitat. We explore different niches, terrestrial, non-terrestrial or terrestrial niches, and from plant also, from microbes. We also collaborate with some chemistry people and and of NIPER, CDR, and some other institute, and they give us this semi-synthetic library. That is synthetic library designer. If we have a target, we get the designer library. We design based on this docking study. We design different molecules and we test against that target. And also we use my lab or somebody's lab is working on a couple of targets, they can use this FDA approved library. It is the it is around 2,000 to 3,000 molecules around, right? So that can be repurposed, although they have some indication, but we can use for some other indication. By basically it is trial and error kind of thing. So these are the various reasons for resistance in bacteria. This is underexpression of proteins and overexpression efflux pump. This modification, antibiotic enzyme modification and active site modification. These are the different reasons for this antibiotic resistance. So this is the way we work, right from the niche selection, niche isolation of this microbe, purification of microbes, and then fermentation, and then making the extract, and then separation of the fraction, bioactivity guided fractionation, and then isolation of the active peaks and chemical characterization, and then looking for this safety profile of the compounds, and then go for some other assays for mode of action. This is the way we work. This is the flow chart, how we work: screening, purification, experimental evaluation, proof of concept, and then lead optimization, in vivo evaluation, toxicology studies, and then DMPK, normal we say drug metabolism and pharmacokinetics. So this is the way the strategy. But another strategy, as I said, if we get this analogs, right? So virtual toxicity, docking, and then designing the analogs, then virtual toxicity. There are several softwares. At least you will get some idea about PKPD kind of, if you have a PK value of the compound, right? So you can manage it. And then again, this basically virtual toxicity is to just narrow down the number of compounds, because the synthesis of each and every component is difficult. So narrow down the based on this lead on virtual studies, then synthesize those analogs which are better, and then again go for experimental evaluation, proof of concept, and lead. And this is the routine and standard protocol of each drug discovery or antibiotic discovery. So I'm talking today about this new antibiotic against gram-negative infection. Manoj was one of the person who is in McMaster University of Canada these days. He is the person who invented this antibiotic. Kushali is working on that, and Parminder is also now working on that on other aspects. So what it this cartoon says, I am deadliest pathogen, right? But when you get the tridecaptin, is rest in peace. So this is the basically. I just told everybody every antibiotic was working as it is silver bullet, but if tridecaptin is in the clinical practice, then rest in peace. So this is the way we did it. We got the sample from Molvi village of Haryana, and we got several isolates. And we did antimicrobial screening, identification, and the bioactivity guided fractionation. Right, we got two compounds. One was active against gram-positive strains, bacterial strain, and another gram-negative stain. So, and then we do this MS, amino acid, NMR, whole genome sequence, MALD, and those things give FTIR. And then what we do in vitro is MIC determination, time till kinetics, mechanism of action, toxicity studies, and in vivo studies. This is the way, this is the flow chart of the, what we do, right? And I'm not going to talk today about this, the compound which was against antibiotic, against gram-positive bacteria. This is already published. What we did here in vitro assays of MIC determination, kill kinetics, mechanism action, and this is actually penicillin. So we are talking about this tridecaptin. This is class of NRPS. So later M derived from the village Malvi. That's why we have given this tridecaptin, this well known class, but this is explored in 30 years back, but it was never this clinical or even preclinical studies was never done, because there that time there was option of colistin and polymyxin B, both are working well against this. So researchers did not thought ki it is required. So again we started, and now this is working, and the beauty of this antibiotic, it is working against colistin resistance bacteria. That is the beauty. That's why this antibiotic is important, because the resistance is reported against colistin. And if you go and what is the spectrum of this antibiotic? This is, we designated as 152P3, and we can compare with polymyxin B, because it is a lipopeptide kind of antibiotic. So that's why we comparing with polymyxin B and colistin. And you can see this is the spectrum. If you see this three columns of activity, so there is not a great thing with respect to polymyxin B and colistin. But if you go next, all resistance strain we obtained from Apollo Hospital, Chennai, and Dr. Abdul Ghafoor is our collaborator. And you can see how it works against these strains. It is much better against this colistin resistor. That is the beauty of this antibiotic. We use more or less almost all the class of antibiotics, and we characterize these strains, and then we use tridecaptinium, how it works against those strains. So the MIC, this table suggests it can be a very good candidate against. So M152-3P3 showed a potent antibacterial activity against colistin resistance Klebsiella pneumoniae, clinical isolate. Hence, no, because this is new antibiotic, so the possibility of the cross resistance with polymyxin is less. Then we did how it works. It is important to establish the mechanism of action, how it works. So in this graph here, you can see here this this outer membrane permeabilization, ONPG assay, and polymyxin is the well standard antibiotic which is working in this mechanism. But our antibiotic, you can see this green and blue. It is not. Again, another ONPG assay we did it, but this is not. But if you go this for C, this membrane depolarization, there is some effect. So there is some effect in C as well as even D, ATP determination. So this is directly related to membrane depolarization disruption is there, then the ATP synthesis will be disturbed. And that's how it is depicting in C and D. So it is disturbing the ATP synthesis. And then again, we did here this E and F ATP determination assay, where it shows the growth of untreated culture and treated with subinhibitory concentration. And you can see here this after 2 hours. In untreated, there is a significant growth. Similarly, in the F, untreated, there is a bioluminescence because the ATP is not disrupted. So, and treated, there is. So M152P3 or other members of this triadecaptin family interact with LPS to enter periplasmic space where they specifically bind to lipid 2 and then create the proton-specific poles. This assault prompts an alteration in membrane potential and proton motive force, apparently leading to blockage of cell energy generation system and eventually cell. This is the mechanism. It is different than polymic cell and cholesterol. Then to go for safety profile, it is non-hemolytic, and because our working concentration is 2 to 4 to maximum 8 microgram per ml, so it is safe antibody. We lead with HEK and J774 cell lines. And then we have gone, actually it was a kind of acute toxicity, although not a single dose, but kind of acute toxicity. So we compare with colistin, and actually human effective dose of colistin is around 900 milligram per day. So it comes around 50 milligram per kg body weight. But in fact, we dose more concentration of antibiotic than the HED. So most of these animals are died after 4 hours. And 6 hours, all animals are died in case of colistin. But this our antibiotic all are surviving. In fact, we are repeating this because this is already we qualified DMPK studies outsourced from Anthem, and now we are again 14 days repeat dose study we are doing. But we are very hopeful it will qualify because this previous toxicity assays it says. And there is hardly any damage in the vital organs, kidney, liver, and brain after the histopathology studies. And then, as I said, it is working against normal strain, but it is working better in Klebsiella pneumoniae with MCR, this colistin resistance strains with MCR genes. So there is a significant log difference in the in case of colistin, and if you compare our antibiotic, there is a significant log difference, and hence we can say one this tridecaptin appeared safe to RBCs and mammalian cell lines at a concentration much higher than its effective concentration in bacteria, and there. Also, there is no acute toxicity was observed in the animal model at the administered dose. Above all, the compound exhibited remarkable efficacy in the thigh infection model against colistin resistance of Klebsiella pneumoniae. So then what we did, actually this strain is making many variants of tridecaptin, and there is a difference in small difference in amino acids. So we isolated more or less all variants, right? This is the original one, and this is the variants. You can see this HPLC profile, and we did some mass spectroscopy, and there is a sequence. This is the sequence of different variants, and we modified at 5 position, 9 position. 11 position, some modification, major modification is there at 5, 9, 11, 12 position. And then we did this susceptibility against those strains, and then natural variants. And M11 is one of the good variant, but the quantity of this M11 is very less, so we did not continue for this ML11. We are still continuing on M tridecaptin M. This profile, this for M11, this profile, of course, it is good. We did effect of bacterial load on MSC. Then kill kinetics, you can see here, we use different loads, bacterial load, still this antibiotic 10 to power 9, 10 to power 8, 10 to power 7, 6. And the behavior, although we increase the load, the behavior of the antibiotic tritactin is very good. And you can see B, time kill kinetics, and measurement and in different concentration. Here is the different point, half MIC, 1 MIC, 2 MIC, 4x MIC, different MICs we chosen, and then observed this time kill kinetics. And then we also did time kill studies using spread plating method, and similar results were obtained. What we did, we studied these variants, different variants, and NPN, we did this tridecatin M11 and then tridecatin M. And you can see here, this membrane depolarization assay and this outer membrane assay, the behavior of this, all these variants, 11, tridecaptin M, is same. Similarly, in depolarization assay where this ATP digester was takes place, so valinomycin is the appropriate standard here, and we use that valinomycin, and you can see the pattern. When we use different concentration of tridecaptin M at 4 microgram per ml and 8 microgram per ml, there is a disruption of membrane, and this can be seen in the terms of fluorescence count. We explored, is it possible to combine this antibiotic with some other antibiotic? So in synergistic activity with rifamycin, we have done and vancomycin also. So rifamycin and vancomycin, when we synergize this antibiotic at some concentration, so there is a significant modulation this of the antibiotic, this rifamycin and vancomycin both place. This is the fold modulation, means that means 16 times the MIC of rifamycin, or MIC of vancomycin, was reduced in the presence of this much of concentration of this antibiotic. Then we did, and this was very well observed in Acinetobacter baumini. So then we used different strains, clinical as well as type strains of baumini. And you can see here, and we took all the most of the major classes of antibiotic which are used in the clinical practice, and there is a, you can see this, how this synergy works with the different classes of antibiotics and tridecaptin M. So 5 different classes of antibiotics we took, and strain was various strains of A. baumini, and you can see here, tridecaptin M sensitized MDR A baumini strain to various antibiotics such as rifamycin, vancomycin, and ceftazidime. There are different class of antibiotics. And then we did some time kill assays with the different concentration, with the specific concentration of rifamycin alone and in combination with rifamycin, tridecaptin M and tridecaptin alone. You can see here this graph, and also we did this in ex vivo infection model using this rabbit blood, and there is a significant log difference. You can see is rifamycin plus tridecaptin M and then tridecaptin M. So this red circle is the log difference. So tridecaptin M and rifamycin combination killed the bacteria completely in 4 hours, and in ex vivo blood infection model, superior to rifamycin monotherapy. And then we did how it works, whether it can be given either in simultaneously or in the joint dose or first in this rifamycin and tridecaptin model we established. Even this, if we give first at a one shot, also it is working. Even we give this antibiotic try once is treated with rifamycin, and after 4 hours, if we supply tridecaptinium, that is also working. So, and then in here, what we did, this bacteria were pre-treated with tridecaptinium for 2 hours, at 4 hours, and then tridecaptin was removed and then added rifamycin to right here in C and D. So it is working. And even we made some persister cells, and the rate of persister cell formation is less in case of when we supply this tridecaptinium. The combination therapy of RIF and tridecaptinium, either of any drug simultaneously given or at a time, both doesn't make difference. The combination hampered the survival of persister cells in abominate comparison to rifamycin alone. Then what we thought, we will synthesize this different by chemical synthesis. We synthesize the sequence, and we modified certain, we have done some certain modification in the sequence, and we found this, and this sequence with octanoic acid is good and given good result. But the why we have not opted this synthetic route, because synthesis is very costly, right? So again we continued for fermentation, and then we did different optimization studies by managing different components, right? We different salts, divalent salts, and the different media also we use different then we induce with some small concentration of tridecaptinium, and then see the production, and also then we use different source of carbon as well as nitrogen source, and finally we finalize this media, which is giving we could achieve 40 to 45 milligram per liter, right, after optimization from initial 2 milligram per liter. And then OFAT optimization also, we did it this one factor at a time, the shake flask level, and we optimized this RPM, how much this agitation shaking in the fermentation of 5 liter, and then inoculum size and starch concentration and different carbon source glycerol. Finally, starch was replaced with glycerol because this analysis of this residual carbon was easy. So we again gone for the starch and glycerol. Glycerol is giving equally good activity. The challenge is here, we are improving the strain because this concentration, this titer of the antibiotic is not enough for making the process economical. Our target is around 400 milligram per liter of titer of this antibiotic, and this work is still on. And recently we sent this antibiotic 2-3 months back to Anthem Hyderabad, and they did this DMPK studies where all these parameters, plasma protein binding, CYP inhibition, metabolic study in liver microscope, human rat and mouse, PK in SD rat, then HERG immunity inhibition assay, and then AMS test, these all parameters, this antibiotic is qualifying. So it can be a very good antibiotic in future. And now we are exploring this 14 days non-GLP toxicity, and if it qualifies 14 days non-GLP tox and acute tox, then only we will go for GLP tox, and that will be the end of IND process filing. And if we summarize this thing, cladicaptemia is active against colistin and carbapenem resistance enterobacteria. Cladicaptemia do not share mechanism of action with any other clinically used antibiotic. That's why the chances of cross region are rare. And then this antibiotic was non-hemolytic, even at certainly good high concentration and even mammalian cell, and safety index is more than 25. It is said that it is good safety index in most of the clinical studies. Some of the natural variants of tridecaptin are more active than original, as I said, tridecaptin M, that 11 variant. And tridecaptin M synthesized MDR abominite to various antibiotics, such as rifamycin, vancomycin, and ceftazidime. This antibiotic and rifamycin combination killed the bacteria completely in porous next view of blood infection model and was superior to rifamycin monotherapy. This combination hampered the survival of persistent development in abomina in comparison to standalone single monotherapy rifamycin. This finding makes the tridecaptin an excellent candidate against drug resistance bacteria to be developed in future for its detailed PKPD study. Already we did it, it is qualified. It is qualified DMPK studies, non-regulatory toxicity is under, and strain improvement it is. These are the paper, recent paper we published on repurposing also, we published about this antibiotic also, molecules, AEM, ACS infectious disease, ASM microbial. These are the last year papers. And regarding this, our repurposing this efflux inhibitor combination with antibiotic, FDA-approved antibiotic, that was also published on our, that idea was published on this cover of AEM. And last year, I got this special recommendation in AMR Quest, conducted by SICCAM Bangalore. These are our collaborators. Sanjay Jajak is the NIPAR professor in natural product chemistry. Ashish is the CDRI scientist who does NMR. Prabhat Ranjan is the formulation person. Sushil Maurya, he was in Aurangabad for Wakhard many years, and right now he is in the ISBT Palampur. Inshad Ali Khan, now he left to Central University of Hyderabad. Initially, he was in IIIM. Professor Abdul Ghafoor is the AMR convener of India, Apollo, and he is associated with Apollo Super Speciality Hospital, Chennai. Vaita Hopper from SRM University. We got some strains. Varsha Gupta from GMCH 32, local hospital, and Nigel Viveris and Simon Gibbs. They have given some designer strain for the C plus post studies and etc. And this is my team, this Professor Bob Ganguly. I think Pune people may be knowing this guy. He is no more. He died a couple of years back. He was associated with, Agarkar Research Institute. Professor Bir Ganguly, he is from Thane. His family is in Thane. And Manoj, this is the Manoj Rushali. And Rishikesh is already in Oklahoma University, is working as a postdoc. And Parminder and Rushali, she is also from Pune. She's right now working on next level of the tridecaptin M antibiotic development. That's it. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. Indeed, it was such an elaborative and enlightening presentation. Sir shed light on discovery to development, the serious impact of the gram-negative bacteria, and the measures to deal with AMR. This is such an important aspect, sir. Thank you. I sincerely appreciate the great efforts which are taken by you and the valuable time which you have given us from your hectic schedule. Now, the session is opened for the question and answers. If someone has any questions for sir, kindly share it in the chat box, or you may directly unmute yourself. Any question, participants? Sir, I think it was so much self-explanatory that there are no questions because it was a wonderful session. Thank you again.
Sir, I have one question.
Okay. You can ask many questions.
Sir, you mentioned that this antibiotic has been tested in combination with rifampin for checking whether persister cells remain or not. Mm-hmm. So has it been tested by itself to check for presence of persister cells?
Yeah, both the cases. In combination with rif and tridecaptinem, and alone tridecaptinem, and alone rifamycin also. So
there were no persisters.
It reduces the persister cell formation in combination.
That is very fascinating, sir. Very fascinating. Because yeah. I did my PhD on persister cells. So it is an exciting molecule to study.
Because why we are trying this kind of studies combination, and because we are exploring the all angle potential, how it can be a drug candidate or in future. Because this is one of our fast track translation FTT project in CSIR. Only challenge for I will tell you at this position, this is DMPK qualified. And I think tox will also qualify. Only issue with us is strain improvement that is not producing more than 40. So we are trying. Yes. If it is, then it can be a great technology because it is working against colistin resistance.
Right. Thank you, sir.
Any more question? You can ask anything. Anybody can ask anything.
Any questions, participants? Thank you so much, sir. Thank you again. And I request all the participants to switch on their camera so that we may have a group photo with sir.
Okay. Shall I stop sharing? Shall I do stop sharing?
Yes, sir.
Dear participants, please switch on your cameras.
So
thank you so much. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.
So it is over. Today's session is over.
Yes, sir. I would request Dr. Ekta ma'am to conclude this wonderful lecture series. Over to you, Ekta ma'am.
Even previous lecture was, I think I was looking for this this biodata. He is Fazman, this in the bracket.
Yes, sir.
Dr. Ramesh, he is from Vellore, VIT, right?
Vellore. VIT. Yes, sir.
Good. Thank you, Ekta, for calling me.
Thank you, sir. Thank
and,
you so much.
Actually, we are not familiar with this platform, Google Meet. But last time in that. What college?
Abhidhananda.
It was not, I did not face problem. I don't know why, what was happening. And in fact, I directly connected that link. It is not downloaded, this Google Meet. Probably that may be the reason.
Okay, probably, sir.
So it is offline classes these days now? Yeah, online.
So we had actually begun with offline, blended mode. For students who were double vaccinated, they could come offline. For those who had not finished their vaccination regimen, they could attend online.
But cases are coming. Actually, my institute also got some couple of cases in last 2-3 days.
So that's what today.
Again, it is being serious problem like April, May.
Yes. sir. So probably we have not gotten any instruction from the college as such yet.
Maharashtra,
but today we'll find out whether
Maharashtra and Delhi is the on top actually.
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you very much. Discuss offline any day.
Yes, sir. Definitely.
Anytime, any months, the COVID situation. I will also visit your college if I come.
Very welcome, sir. Anytime.
Yeah. So I saw this Sayed with that Abhinay Inamdar College last week. He was talking to students. Sayed Inamdar is an NCL person.
Yes,
What is it? Dastagir.
Dastagir, sir.
Yeah. He's NCL person. He is also good. He is doing good work. Sayed Dastagir. Yeah. Okay, bye-bye. Have a nice day. Bye.
Thank you, sir.
Bye-bye. Okay, bye. See you.
In summary of the two-day lecture series on overcoming the challenge of antimicrobial resistance, I'm happy to share some of the highlights of the lectures given by our dynamic speakers. Dr. Karishma Pardesi gave us a very concise overview of hospital-acquired infections and how they contribute to antimicrobial resistance, and how alternative mono and combination therapies are being studied for their potential use in treatment of MDR infections. Dr. Siddharth Chopra, sir, introduced us to resistance mechanisms on a molecular level and how they translate to real-world scenarios. He also explained how his research team is studying repurposing of already available drugs to combat escape pathogens, given the large amount of time required to develop marketable drugs. Dr. Ramesh Nachimuthu today explained how resistance develops due to overuse, misuse, and inadequate amounts of antibiotics. He also gave a very interesting perspective on how phages came to be recognized for their potential use as alternative treatment strategy for infection. So I explained what the typical flow of experiments is in researching phages in vitro and in vivo. Dr. Hemraj Nandanwar, sir, discussed how various molecules that were left behind in research are studied today for their use against gram-negative bacteria. Sir also introduced us to the new antibiotic, Tridecaptin M, that has shown excellent activity. All in all, the lecture series was a success in spreading the message of antimicrobial awareness and introducing students to a new avenue of research. I thank all our speakers for this. Dear participants, no event can happen without the provision of a vast network of people. It is my pleasure to present the vote of thanks for such a vibrant team. First, I thank respected Dr. R.S. Runzar Rao, the principal of Modern College Shivaji Nagar, for his motivation for making this event successful. I also thank respected Dr. Anjali Sardesai, ma'am, Vice Principal Academics, Vice Principals of Science, Arts and Commerce Faculty, as well as heads of all departments for their support. I express my gratitude towards Dr. Shilpa Muzumdar, head of Department of Microbiology, without whose support and guidance the event was not possible. I must remark a proficient sense of gratitude to our speakers of this lecture series, Dr. Karishma Pardesi, Dr. Siddharth Chopra, Dr. N. Ramesh, and Dr. Hemraj Nandanwar, for guiding and motivating our students in an encouraging way. I extend my generous thanks to Nirlekar sir for providing a strong technical support and streaming the event live on YouTube. I take this opportunity to thank the entire committee. I thank Ms. Ankita Kulkarni for scheduling the Google Meets for the lectures. I also thank Ms. Jayashree for coordinating with participants on the YouTube channel. I am thankful to Mrs. Madhuri Kothavade for taking us through the entire series in a smooth flow with her comparing. I also extend my thanks to Ms. Sheetal Pardeshi, Mrs. Anushka Devade, Mrs. Rupali Savan, Mrs. Bhumika Karamchandani, Ms. Saili Ketivar, Ms. Dimple Parate, Ms. Jayashree Bhoyar, and Ms. Lavina Pinto for extending their hand in help to introduce the esteemed speakers and coordinating the question and answer session. A special mention of Mrs. Rupali Savan for her help at every step in organizing this event, from arranging the finances to making feedback forms. I also thank the audience for presenting their valuable views in the session and for their active participation. With this, I announce that the lecture series on overcoming the challenges of antimicrobial resistance